Thank you, Matthew. I hope this microphone will work because I don't know if I can speak as loud as you for 40 minutes, but I'll do my best. And thank you for introducing the issue for tonight so personally, because it makes us reflect a lot on how these events also affect us in our own story. Thank you very much for this invitation for these marathon talks. It's an honor to be given this opportunity, and it's a real pleasure being in Rome, not only because it's a city of the founding European treaties that were signed not far from here in 1957, but also more so because it's Rome is the heartland of European civilization. And it makes sense to talk about Europe here in Rome, but also specifically here in this in the international environment that these wonderful schools offer. And being both in Rome and in this particular school, it gives the perfect setting to look at the EU both from the inside and the outside, from an internal and an international perspective. I would almost say to speak Urbi and Torbi, but I wouldn't dare, I have no capacity absolutely to do so, so I wouldn't dare do it, especially here in Rome. But the place is appropriate, and the timing couldn't be more appropriate, the timing of this talk. We are ahead of upcoming European elections in May, and closer to us, much closer than ever, to the much awaited and feared Brexit, perhaps at the end of this month, perhaps later on. We'll know more in the coming hours and days what's going to happen. In any case, we're talking about the very near future of the EU and about the great democratic challenges that these two events, the Brexit and the European elections, are putting in front of us, in front of the EU. So first, the Brexit. We're less than 3 weeks ahead of the official withdrawal of the UK, that is supposed to happen on March 29th at midnight, Brussels time, 11 p.m. London time. And it's amazing that no one here, no one in Brussels, no one in London can be sure how it's going to happen really, just 3 weeks from now, as we are speaking tonight. We can discuss the possible options later, perhaps during our Q&A session. But let me first address the Brexit issue from a broader view. Why is it a democratic challenge for us all? I think the European integration process is a democratic one. All member states of the EU, the 28 member states at present, were free to join, and they were willing to do so. No one was first ever to come. And the UK, remember, joined and held the first referendum in June 1975 to see if the Brits wanted to join. And I don't know if you remember the result of that first referendum in 1975. You know, but over 67% of the Brits who said yes at the time, we want to be part of the so-called European communities. It wasn't the European Union at the time. There was another referendum before in Norway, and the Norwegians said no, we don't want to be part of it. That was in 1972. And they had another referendum in 1994, when they said again, no, we don't want to be. So Norway is not part of the EU. But no one is forced to join. Croatians, for instance, who were the last to join in 2013, they had a referendum in 2012 where a majority of Croatians also voted yes to be part of the EU. And when I refer to these consultations, to these referendums, I'm talking about real democracy. I know there's a lot has been said about the Brexit campaign and how awful it was, but it was a real referendum. And to be a member of the EU, not only you have to have the will, the sovereign choice that people make to join, but also you have to be a democracy. I mean, the referendum must be a real one. And for instance, Spain only joined once it became a democracy after the Franco regime. Portugal joined after the end of the Salazar dictatorship. Greece had joined perhaps a bit early, in 1981, after the also dictatorship of the colonial regime, and the whole Eastern Bloc joined after the collapse of the Iron Curtain. So you have to be a democracy in order to be to join, and then you have to want to join. And the thing is, it's like in a club, to join, the others have to accept you. To have your membership, all the others, each one of them, have to accept you. And if you remember on the case of the UK, France said no to the UK membership. They even said twice. They both said no in 1963 and 1967. And how do you overcome a no from De Gaulle? From the Grand Charles. Well, it takes the whole French people. So there was a French referendum, as I think we all forgot about. There was a referendum in 1972 where the French people said, yes, we want the Brits to join. Over 68% of the French voters accepted to the UK to be part of Europe. The turnout was quite low, I must say, but it was 68%. So, and that's actually the only referendum I know about in France for membership. Usually, when there's a new country coming in, all the other members who are already in don't go through a referendum, usually, but through the treaty of this country is ratified by each parliament in all countries. So, for instance, if you take the last who turned in Croatia in 2013, the French parliament voted yes for Croatia to come in, as did the UK, as did Slovenia, not easily, but it did. And all the other, each of the other 27 member states individually said, yes, we want Croatia to be part of the club. And if one single country says no, it cannot join. So that's how it's done. The reason I insist on this is to highlight the democratic process of becoming a member state. The EU is not the Roman Empire. To make a marriage to be valid, the consent must be free in Rome. There's no forced marriage, right? Well, it's the same case for EU. No one was forced to come, and no one is forced to stay either. Divorce is allowed in the EU. No European troops have been sent to London to stir them, you know, stay. So that's why, if it truly respects the people's will, I believe Brexit must happen at the end of the day. It would be pointless to hold a new referendum just now, since you had one not so long ago. But you cannot just jump in or jump out just like that. There needs to be an agreement, a treaty. There was an agreement and a treaty written to join, so there should be a deal to leave. And that's what we call an orderly withdrawal. And that's what the Article 50 of the treaty, of the EU treaty, provides for. And it's not just a legal matter, it's a real democratic challenge. A no deal, which could happen, is like slamming the door. It's like leaving your job without any notice to anyone. It's legal because once the UK has notified its will to exit, it has 2 years to find this agreement. And if nothing happens after those 2 years, but that's 29 March coming, it can legally leave. But it's not the gentleman way of leaving. It's more insulting to your partners. It's irrespectful of them, and I don't think it will help for the future relationship and for knowing that the EU is the UK's biggest neighbor. So everyone else is watching carefully how this will unfold, because it has never happened before. So, and the way it is handled is highly important also for all the other member states. Not just for economic reasons, according to each country's exposure to the British market and the risk of chaos and the logistic nightmare it may lead to, but moreover for what it tells about the EU. In that sense, I think the Brexit is a paradox, because it is sending two opposite signals. think the loud signal, the most perhaps dramatic that is descending, is that it has showed us that European integration is not an ever ending story. That the EU is fragile and that it is mortal. Now, when I grew up, I grew up with the belief that the EU was sort of a nice process, always going on, enlarging, deepening, and this would go on forever. It was irreversible. As the European treaties are signed forever, they are endless. And so, no matter what happens, Brexit has already proven that we're not in an ever closer union as we thought. I think it opened a taboo in that sense. The Euro crisis had already sent such a signal that the greatest achievement of European integration, the single currency, could collapse. So I think through Brexit we recognize how fragile our union is. Because we're talking about a big member state, the UK. If it were a very small, tiny country, I won't mention any names, leaving the EU, perhaps there won't be such a big fuss about it. But the fact that the UK, one of the biggest member states, one of the big players of the Union, is leaving, of course, weakens us globally, because on the global stage then, we are not as great as we are with Great Britain. The weak signal, perhaps the other signal sent by Brexit, is that EU matters more than you think. Leaving the EU is not like leaving any other international organization, say UNESCO or something else. I'm not diminishing at all the importance of them, but we can see that it's different. The other 27 member states hold to it. When Brexit happened, we gave you the impression we had in London, the impression in France, where there'd be a domino effect. With Brexit, the beginning of other Frexit, Taxit, Polxit, whatever, Chexit. And there were elections coming up in the Netherlands, and an important presidential election in France just some months later. And that was the fear, that Brexit, the beginning of the process. And actually, thanks to Brexit, if I may say it that way, we are rediscovering what it means, for instance, to have a new passport. You just mentioned it. Perhaps you didn't before. Thought it was that important. We are rediscovering what it means to have a customs union. We are rediscovering what it means to have a single market or a European budget to benefit from trade agreements negotiated by the EU. All this, I think, before was taken for granted, forgotten, or simply ignored. And I think through Brexit we are measuring the value of our own assets as a union. And the UK is realizing how difficult it would be to rely only on its own ones, on its own assets. And I think it's also realizing that it has really lost its empire. I think the Brexiters who believe in a new deal still believe in some kind of empire. And that's perhaps there might be some reality check behind this. Now, it's hard to forecast what effect the Brexit will have or not have on the upcoming European elections next May. Last week, you may saw in France, President Macron sent an EU-wide address for these elections, and he tried to use the Brexit moment to show that the best way for European countries to, I quote, take back control, as he said, taking the slogan of the Brexiters, to take back control of your destiny when facing big powers, superpowers, global threats, and actually to be united with other European countries. And I think that's really the purpose, more than ever, of the EU today, what it's really about, more than ever. I would like to refer to a recent speech delivered in Bologna last week by Mario Draghi, the president of the ECB, where he points out the difference between being sovereign and being independent. He said you can be independent in the sense that you can be free to make your own national laws, that you're not really sovereign if you have no control on big events that are happening throughout the world when facing other things. And so the difference between you can be independent but not really sovereign actually of your own destiny. And that's, I think, important when understanding the purpose of EU versus being out. But being united doesn't mean creating some sort of a super state or federation or some. It does mean that.